In the last video, I talked about benefits of air gap technology, and we established that it's a pretty cool thing, whether it's in your aerosol or whether it's in semiconductor technology. So the next $1 million question is, how do we make these air gap? That is, you know, how do I form these air gaps? So this is, you know, my typical Damascene process flow, and the way it would work is I would have a dielectric and I would create these molds, and then I would fill them or electroplate them with the copper. So being the dark that I am, you know, the very simple, the first thought that comes to your mind, how to create this air gap is to essentially, why not, you know, just etch this dielectric out. So, you know, we could do a very selective etch, which etches this dielectric out, and we are left with this air gap between our copper lines. And this is this would have been a fine approach if there was only one level of interconnect, but the problem is that we have multiple levels of these interconnects, and what I want is I want on the top another set of interconnects, and then I'll be having vias which would land on these first level of interconnects. So these vias cannot land on thin air, or all these other levels on the top cannot be made on top of air. So this clearly doesn't work. So let's look at something which does. So I want to talk about three different ways of making these air gaps, and the first one is really one which uses this approach, which is I'm labeling it as using a sacrificial polymer and a porous dielectric. To give you some reference, this was approach which was really publicized by IBM back in 2007, using their self-assembly to form this porous dielectric. So the way this approach works is that you have these copper lines, and I clear up the dielectric between them, and now what I do is I fill it up with this polymer, which I'll sacrifice, hence the name is sacrificial polymer. So I intend to not keep this but remove it, and then I cap this structure with this dielectric. And so I cap the structure with a dielectric, and my sacrificial polymer is below this dielectric. And the neat thing, or the unique thing about this dielectric, is that it's a porous dielectric, or it has, you know, in some way, it has a way where either you can, let things into it, or you can let things out of it. So it's a two-way street. You can essentially let things in, and you can let things out. And the way IBM formed this was using a self-assembly, and they would create these tiny little pores using a self-assembly method. So what do you do after you have these pores is you can do either of these two things. What you can do is you can heat your substrate, and you can heat your whole wafer, and this sacrificial polymer can go out, and it would essentially remove this sacrificial polymer from between this copper wire. Or the other thing you can do is you can wet etch this polymer. So you can let some chemical in, and that again would achieve the same end, that you remove this polymer in between these copper wires. So these are two ways, and then essentially what you're left with is this air gap between your copper wires, which is what you wanted to start with. The challenges with this approach is that you have to heat it up, so you have to go to higher temperature, and which might damage your transistor below. Or if you wet etch it, then you can, you know, corrode. There's always a chance that you can corrode these metal lines here. But this is a, you know, a very viable approach of making these interconnects. So let's look at another approach of forming this air gap, and this one utilizes the non-conformal nature of our CVD process. So if the last approach was cooler, this one is even more cool. It's super cool. And it's really an approach which converts, which takes a bug and converts it into a feature. So we talked about this non-conformal nature of our CVD process. We discussed that, you know, we always have higher growth rate on the cell it receives on the corners because it receives a larger amount of flux. And that results in this closure of the step profile, or a pinch up of these step profile. And if we, you know, continue on this path, what you get is essentially you start two of your two of these fronts, they start to meet each other, and eventually they meet and there's a seam left in between. And if you notice what's happening below, essentially below you are forming this air gap. The next important thing to do is, you know, to seal off this seam. And what people do is, once this seam has formed, they switch to a slightly different process or plasma, so they can start using a high density plasma, which results in a more conformal deposition. And then you deposit this conformal layer once you have formed this air gap. So that pinches off this seam over here, so the seam does not propagate, and what you are left with essentially is this air gap. So we have formed this air gap between our metal lines. And you know, this is what I really like about it. You know, this was something which was a bug that, you know, we had this this pinch off, but now that we have sealed this bug inside to, you know, to sort of make fun of it, now we have converted it into a feature. And the next thing to do is essentially, once you have, you know, formed this air gap, what we can do is then, you know, come off and we can essentially polish or do a CMP step and then planarize, and what we are left with is essentially this air gap, which is now trapped between these copper metal lines. And two important things to, you know, keep in mind, or two challenging things, is to really, you know, seal off that seam, because if that seam exists over here, then if you do any further wet processing, that wet chemical can go into and damage this bug over here. So it will again, you know, recreate this bug, so we don't want that. The other important thing to, another caveat is, again, when you are doing CMP, when you are doing this CMP step, you don't want to expose your air gap. So you want to very carefully control your CMP so that, you know, you don't polish it off over here. Then you will be again exposing this air gap, and this bug can get out, and you know, all kind of chemicals can get in. So those are two important things to keep in mind if you are forming this air gap using this non-conformal CVD process. So another good thing about this, using this non-conformal CVD, is that it results in air gap where we need them the most. So this is, you know, I point this out using this image over here. So clearly, you know, if you use a non-conformal CVD process, it would form this air gap between this these two metal lines, which have the closest space between them. But if there are these two other metal lines which are far apart, this level of non-conformality might not be enough, and over there you might get, you know, a fill without air gap. So which is fine, because we wanted the air gap or this capacitance between these two alternate metal lines was most significant there when they were close to each other. So it forms the air gap where we needed it the most, and that's, you know, kind of good, because we can get the air gaps where we need the most, right? So to finish up, I want to just point out another approach. And since, you know, we talked about approach which was cool, we talked about approach which was super cool, and since we are talking about cool things, I consider this is an approach which is uber cool. And The way it works is, you know, you want to create all these other approaches. You created this level of air gap at each level of interconnect. So if you had you know, one if you had multiple levels of this interconnect, you would essentially, you know, create one air gap here, create another air gap here, create another air gap here, and each would require a separate process flow for creating this air gap. What this approach, which was proposed by Toshiba, does is again, it creates a multi-level air gap. So what you do is you form all these different interconnects without worrying about the air gap, and then you essentially create this via which goes through all these interconnect level. And then you perform a etch, very selective etch, and that essentially removes this dielectric among all these levels. So what you're left with is this multi-level air gap. So you form these air gap at different levels all at the same time. Again, it's something which is uber cool, but it's not practically implemented because, again, it's very tough to prevent collapse and other things if you form air gap this way. But nonetheless, since we are talking about cool thing, this is a pretty cool approach to do that as well.